educational task of Central Europe? My dear friends, during the days I am to spend here, I had intended to give a kind of supplement to last year's introductory education course. But the days are so few, and after what I have just been told, there are so many things to be done that I can hardly say whether it will be possible to get beyond these scanty introductory words. It is almost impossible to speak of any kind of program. I should like first to add to what I said to you last year about the teacher, the educator. Of course, all I shall say about the teacher's intrinsic being must be understood in a completely aphoristic way, and it will really be best if it gradually takes its true form within you yourselves, developing further through your own thinking and feeling. The College of Teachers must become aware that teachers especially must have a deep feeling for the nature of the esoteric. And in calling your attention to this, I will remind you that we base our work on anthroposophical spiritual science. In our school, this spiritual science will shape the form of education necessary for our time. In this age of democracy and journalism, it seems that people hardly have a true or valid feeling for what is meant by esoteric. We sometimes believe that what is true, what is right, and the true and the right can be proclaimed before the world once they are formulated in a way one considers correct. But in real life, this is not the case. Things are quite different. In real life, the essential point is that you can unfold a certain kind of effectiveness in your actions only if the impulse for this effectiveness is guarded in the soul as a most sacred secret possession. Teachers in particular must guard many things as sacred secret possessions, and must look upon these as something that only play a part in those meetings and discussions carried on within the College of Teachers itself. At first, a statement of this kind does not seem particularly clear, and yet it will become so. I could say a good deal more, but it will begin to be understandable if I say that the principle I have just stated has universal significance for the present age, embracing the entire civilization of our time. When we think about the education of the young today, we must bear in mind that we are concerned with the feelings, ideas, and will impulses of the next generation. We must be clear that our present task is to prepare this next generation for definite tasks that must be accomplished sometime in humanity's future. When this is said, the question at once arises, why is it then that humanity has reached its present condition of widespread misery? Humanity has arrived at this misery because it has, in essential things, really made itself dependent, through and through dependent, on the kind of thinking and feeling peculiar to the West. When someone in Central Europe, someone involved in external public life, a journalist, best-selling author, or the like, speaks today in Berlin or Vienna about Fichte, Herder, or even Goethe, they are further removed from the spiritual impulse living in these great men than they are from what is felt and thought today in London, Paris, New York, or Chicago. Things have gradually developed in such a way that in general our whole civilization has been flooded by the impulses proceeding from the philosophy of the Western nations. Our whole public life is permeated by their philosophy. This is particularly true of the art of education. From the last third of the 19th century, European nations, generally speaking, have learned from the West in all these matters. Today, those who discuss or dispute questions of education take for granted that they should make use of the habits of Western thought. If you trace back all the educational ideas that are considered reasonable in Central Europe today, you will find their source in the views of Herbert Spencer, or personalities like him. Footnote: Herbert Spencer, 1820-1903, English philosopher. End of footnote. People do not trace out the numerous paths by which the views of Spencer and the others have entered the heads of those who set the tone in cultural and spiritual questions in Central Europe. but these paths exist. They can be found. If you take the spirit of the educational thinking, never mind the details, such as is found in Fichte, it is not only absolutely different from what is generally considered sensible pedagogy today. Modern people are actually hardly capable of bringing their souls into the direction of thinking and feeling needed to conceive how the intentions of Fichte and Herder can be developed further. Thus, we experience in education, especially in the art of education, that what has become the rule is exactly the opposite of what it should be. Let me point out to you what Spencer has written. Spencer was of the opinion that pictorial instruction and object lessons in school should lead, in later years, to the experiments of the naturalist, or into the research of the scientist. What then would have to be done in school? According to him, we should teach children in such a way that when they are grown up and have the opportunity, they can carry on what they have learned in school about minerals, plants, animals, and so on, so that they become proper scientific thinkers. It is true that this kind of idea is frequently opposed, but at the same time, people really put this principle into practice, simply because our textbooks are put together with this in mind. No one would think of altering or doing away with our textbooks. Our botany textbooks today are written more for future botanists than for human beings in general. In the same way, zoology textbooks are not written for everyone, but for future zoologists. Now, the remarkable thing is that we ought to strive for the exact opposite of what Spencer laid down as a true educational principle. When we are teaching children about plants and animals in our elementary schools, we could hardly imagine a greater mistake in our educational method than to treat the subject as an introduction to studies required to become a botanist or zoologist. If, on the contrary, you plan your lessons so that your way of teaching about plants and animals hinders the children from becoming botanists and zoologists, you will have acted more wisely than by following Spencer's principle. For no one should become a botanist or zoologist through what he or she learns in the early grades. People become scientists only through their particular talents, revealed by their choice of vocation, which are certain to appear at maturity if there is a true art of education, through their gifts. That is, if one has the gifts necessary for a botanist, one can become a botanist, and if one has the gifts necessary for a zoologist, one can become a zoologist. This can result only from the gifts of the children in question, which is to say through predetermined karma. This must come about by our recognizing that one child has the makings of a botanist and another the makings of a zoologist. It must never be the result of forming our elementary school lessons in any way as a preparation for special scientific activity. Just think what has been happening. Our scientists, sad to say, have been taking on the field of pedagogy. People who have trained themselves to think scientifically have been engaging in education, have taken a most important part in deciding educational questions. The opinion is that the teacher, as such, has something in common with the scientist. A scientific training has actually been accepted as valid educational training, whereas the two should be completely and absolutely different. If the teacher is a scientist and makes it his or her business in a limited sense to think scientifically, that one can do as a private person but not as a teacher, quite often something happens. The teacher will cut a rather comical figure in the classroom, and among the students or colleagues, jokes will be made at his or her expense. Goethe's baccalaureus in the upper classes is not such a rarity as is usually supposed. Footnote from Faust, Part 2, Act 2, a student highly scornful of all his professors. End of footnote. Today, if we were to ask whether we would side with the teachers when the students make jokes about them, or uphold the students, we would in the present state of affairs in education, side more with the students. The direction things have taken can be best observed in our universities. What are the universities, actually? Are they institutions for teaching young men and women, or are they research centers? They would like to be both, and that is why they have become the exaggerations they are today. People even find it an excellent feature of our universities that they are one at the same time, institutions for teaching and for research. But this is just how all the muddle comes into education. It is carried out by scientists, works its way into our highest educational centers, later finds its way down into the high schools, and finally into the elementary schools. However, it cannot be sufficiently borne in mind that the art of education must proceed from life itself, and not from abstract scientific thought. It is peculiar that we have an educational methodology with a wholly scientific direction, while, quite forgotten, is what can be found in Herder, in Fichte, in Jean-Paul, in Schiller, and other great individuals, reminding us that there is really a way of educating drawn directly from life, that is a life-infused education. It is, moreover, the world historical mission of the Central European peoples to cherish and develop this way of educating, to make it their esoteric task to develop it. There is much that will be possible for all humankind to do working together. This must happen if improvement in the social sphere is to come about in the future. But what is emerging as an art of education from the whole of the spiritual culture that is specifically Central European, the peoples of the West will not be able to understand. In fact, it will annoy them. We can only speak to them about the art of education when they have made up their minds to discover and understand the esoteric foundation of spiritual science. All those things people in Germany have looked at with such pride over the last 40 years, those things that have been considered such major advances, are of no possible use to Germany itself. They will just pass over into the dominion of the Western nations. There is nothing to be done about it. We can only hope to awaken so much understanding for the threefolding of the social organism that the Western nations will take part in it. However, we do have something to give the world from Central Europe in respect to the art of education that no one else can give, neither an Eastern nor a Western person. But we must have the discretion to keep this in those circles that are able to understand it. We must understand how to guard it with a certain sense of trust, knowing that it is this guardianship that will make our work effective. You must know what things to be silent about in the presence of certain people if you want to obtain a result. Above all, we must be clear that there is nothing to hope for from the kind of thought coming to us from the West, which is indeed indispensable in many other branches of modern civilization. We must know that there is absolutely nothing to hope for from that quarter for the art of education we have to develop. Herbert Spencer has written something of unusual interest about education. He has compiled a list of axioms, or principles as he calls them, about children's intellectual education. Among these is one on which he lays great emphasis. In teaching, one should never proceed from the abstract, but always from the concrete. One should always elaborate a subject from an individual case. So he writes in his book on education. And there we find, before he enters into anything concrete, the worst thickets of abstraction, finally nothing but abstract straw. And he does not notice that he himself is carrying out the opposite of just those principles he has argued are indispensable. We have here the example of an eminent and leading contemporary philosopher completely contradicting what he has just advocated. You heard last year that our education is not to be built on abstract principles, or on one thing or another that someone says about, quote, not bringing things to the child from outside, but developing the child's individuality, close quote, and so on. You know that our educational art should be built upon a real sympathy with the child's nature, that it should be built up, in the widest sense, on knowledge of the growing child. In our first course of lectures, and then later in our faculty meetings, we have actually brought together everything we need to know about the nature of the growing child. If, as teachers, we can enter into the child's unfolding, out of this understanding will arise the insight into how we need to act. In this respect, as teachers, we must become artists. Just as it is impossible for an artist to pick up a book on aesthetics and then paint or carve according to the principles the writer has laid down, it should also be quite impossible for a teacher to use an, in quotes, educational guide in order to teach. What the teacher does need is insight into what the child really is and is becoming step by step through the stages of childhood. Above all, we should be clear about the following. Say we teach, beginning with the first grade, the six-year-olds. Every time we take a first grade, our teaching will be bad and will have failed to fulfill its purpose if after working with this first grade for a year, we do not say to ourselves, quote, "Who is it now who has really learned the most? It is I, the teacher," close quote. But if we say to ourselves, quote, "At the beginning of this school year, I had excellent educational principles. I have followed the best teaching authorities and have done everything to carry out these principles," close quote. If you really had done this, you most certainly would have taught badly. You would have taught best of all if each morning you had gone into your class in fear and trembling, without very much confidence in yourself, and then declared at the end of the year, "I myself have really learned the most during this year." For your ability to say this depends on your actions. It depends on what you have really done. It depends upon your constantly having had the feeling that you are growing while you are helping the children to grow. The feeling that you are experimenting in the highest sense of the word, that you are not really able to do so very much, but by working with the children, there grows in you a certain strong capacity. Sometimes you will have the feeling that there is not much to be done with this or that kind of child, but you will have taken trouble with them. For other children, owing to their special gifts, you will have acquired a certain experience. In short, you leave the endeavor quite a different person than you were when you began, and you have learned to do what you are incapable of doing when you began to teach a year earlier. At the end of the school year, you say, "Yes, only now can I do what I ought to have been doing." This is a very real feeling, and hiding within it is a certain secret. If at the beginning of the school year you had really been able to do all you could do at the end, you would have taught badly. You gave good lessons because you had to work them out as you went along. I must put this in the form of a paradox. You taught well when you did not know at the beginning what you had then learned by the end of the year. And it would have been harmful if you had already known at the beginning of the year what you had learned by the end. A remarkable paradox. It is important for many people to know this, but it is most important of all for teachers to know it. For this is a special instance of a general truth and insight. No matter what the subject is, a knowledge that can be comprehended in abstract principles, that can be represented by ideas in the mind, is of no practical value. Only what leads to this knowledge, what is found on the way to this knowledge, is of practical value. The kind of knowledge that is ours, after we have taught for a year, first receives its value after our death. It is not until after death that this knowledge rises into such a reality that it can shape our development, that it can develop the individuality further. In life, it is not the ready-made knowledge that has value, but the work that leads to this knowledge. And particularly in the art of education, this work has its own special value. It is the same in education as in the arts. I cannot consider anyone an artist with the correct attitude who does not inwardly acknowledge upon finishing a piece of work, only now can I really do it. I do not think artists have the right attitude if they are satisfied with any work they have done. They may have a certain natural egoistic respect for their work, but they cannot really be satisfied with it. In fact, a completed artwork loses a large part of its interest for the artist, and this loss of interest is due to the particular nature of the knowledge we are gaining while we make something. On the other hand, the living quality in a work of art, the life that springs from it, originates in the fact that it has not yet been transmuted into knowledge. It is the same with the whole organism. Our head is, as in quotes, finished as anything can be finished, for it is formed out of the forces of our last incarnation. It is, in quotes, overripe. All human heads are overripe, even the unripe ones. But the rest of the organism is only at the stage of furnishing the seed for the head in our next incarnation. It is full of life and growth, but it is incomplete. Not until our death will the rest of our organization really show its true form, namely the form of the forces that are at work in it. The constitution of the rest of our organism shows that there is flowing life in it. Ossification is reduced here to the minimum, while in our head it reaches the maximum. A specific kind of inward humility, the sense that we ourselves are still only becoming, is something that will give teachers strength, for more arises out of this feeling than out of any abstract principles. If we stand in our classroom conscious that it is a good thing that we do everything imperfectly, for in that way there is life in what we do, we will teach well. If, on the other hand, we are always patting ourselves on the back over the perfection of our teaching, then it is quite certain we shall teach badly. But now, consider that you have been responsible for teaching the first grade, second grade, and so on. That you have gone through everything that has to be gone through, excitements, disappointments, successes, too, if you will. Consider that you have gone through all the classes of the elementary school. At the end of each year, you have spoken to yourself somehow in the spirit I have just described. And now you make your way back down again from the eighth to the first grade. Well, now it might be supposed that you can say to yourself, "Now I am beginning with what I have learned. Now I shall be able to do it right. I shall be an excellent teacher." But it won't be like that. Experience will bring you inwardly to something quite different. At the end of the second, the third, and each subsequent school year, you will say exactly the same thing out of a right feeling. "I have now learned what it was impossible to learn about 7-, 8-, and 9-year-old children by working with them. At the end of every single school year, I know what I ought to have done." But when you have reached the fourth or fifth school year for the second time, again you will not know how you really ought to have taught. For now you will correct what you thought to be right after you had taught for a year, and so after you have finished the eighth school year and have corrected everything, if you really have the good fortune to begin again in the first grade, you will find yourself in the same position. But now, to be sure, you will teach in a different spirit. If you carry out your teaching duties with inwardly true, noble, and not false doubts, you will find that your diffidence has brought you an imponderable power that will make you peculiarly fitted to accomplish more with the children entrusted to you. This is absolutely true. The effect in one's life, however, will really be only a different one, not one that is so much better, just different. I might say that the quality you bring about in the children will not be much better than the first time. The effect will only be different. You will attain something different in quality, but not much more in quantity. You will attain something that is different in quality, and that is sufficient. For everything we acquire in the way described, with the necessary noble diffidence and heartfelt humility, has the effect that we are able to make individualities out of human beings, individualities in the best sense of the word. We cannot have the same class twice and send out into the world the same copies of a cut and dried educational pattern. We can, however, give the world personalities who are individually different. We bring about diversity in life, but this does not derive from the working out of abstract principles. The diversity depends on the deeper understanding of life that we have just described. You can see from all this that what matters more than anything else in a teacher is the way he or she regards this holy calling. This is not insignificant, for the most important things in teaching and in education are those that are imponderable. A teacher who enters the classroom with this heartfelt conviction achieves something different from one who does not. Just as, in everyday life, it is not always what is physically large that counts, but something quite small, so it is not always what we do with big words that carries most weight. Sometimes it is the perception, the feeling that we have built up in our hearts before we enter the classroom. One thing of special importance is that we must quickly strip off our narrow personal self like a snake skin when we enter the classroom. Teachers may go on through all sorts of experiences between the end of class one day and beginning again on the next because they are, as is sometimes said with such self-satisfaction, really only human. It may be that they have been pressed by their creditors or have quarreled with a spouse, as does happen. There are things that put us out of sorts. Such disharmonies provide an undertone to our state of soul, as do happy, joyous feelings as well. The father of a pupil who particularly likes you may have sent you a pheasant after he has been out hunting, or perhaps a bouquet of flowers. What I mean is that it is quite a natural thing to carry moods of this kind around with us. As teachers, however, we must train ourselves to lay aside these moods and give ourselves up entirely to the content of the subject we are going to teach. We should really be able to describe a subject tragically, taking our mood from the subject, and then pass over into a humorous mood as we proceed with our lesson, surrounding ourselves completely to the subject. The important thing is that we should also be able to perceive the whole reaction of the class to tragedy, or romance, or humor. When we are able to do this, we shall become aware that all three moods are of extraordinary significance for the children's soul life. And if we allow our lessons to be carried along by an alternation of humor, romance, and tragedy, if we pass from one mood into the other and back again, if we are really able, after presenting something for which we needed a certain heaviness, to pass over into a certain lightness, not a forced lightness, but one that arises because we are living in our lesson, then we are bringing about in the children's soul life something akin to the in and out breathing of the bodily organism. As we teach, our object is not simply to teach with and for the intellect, but rather to really be able to consider these various moods. For what is tragedy? What is romance? What is a melancholic mood? It is exactly the same as an inbreathing for the organism, the same as filling the organism with air. Tragedy means that we are trying harder and harder to draw our physical body together, so that in doing so we become aware of the astral body emerging further and further out of it, owing to this contraction. A humorous mood signifies that we paralyze the physical body, but with the astral we do just the opposite of what we did before. We expand it as far as possible, spreading it out over its surroundings, so that we are aware, for example, if we do not merely look at something red, but move out into it, how we spread our astral body over this redness and pass over into it. Laughing simply means that we drive the astral body out of our facial features. It is nothing else but an astral outbreathing. If we want to apply all this in our teaching, we must have a certain feeling for the dynamics. It is not always advisable, on the heels of something heavy and sustained, to go straight over into the humorous. However, we can always find the ways and means in our lessons to prevent the child's soul from being imprisoned by the serious or the tragic, and in extricating it, we will free it so that it can really breathe in and out between the two moods of soul. These are some introductory examples of the various moods teachers should consider while teaching. Certainly, this is just as important as any other specific aspect of education.